Oh, the excitement. Take a chance on me. Introducing my guest, Bjorn Ulvaeus. Hello, how are you?
Hello, Graham. I'm fine.
Good. Yes. You look very well. You look hale and hearty.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Yeah, I had a run this morning on a treadmill at my hotel.
Oh, I was going to say, you can't run in the streets.
No, no, not in the streets of London. That's impossible.
Pursued by fans. I feel like a music video.
Yeah.
So you're in town for this big opening on Thursday, this Thursday,
yes,
at the O2. Mamma Mia, the party,
yeah,
opens.
Yeah.
So, for people who don't know, try to explain what it is, because it is a restaurant, but it's more than that, isn't it?
It is very much more than that. It's like a spin-off within the Mamma Mia world.
Okay. So it's a Greek taverna.
Yeah, it comes from, you know, at the end of Mamma Mia the musical, people stand up and they dance in the aisles and they sing along and stuff like that. And for me, that always seemed like a party mood. And it seemed to me that if there was a party next door, they'd go to it. You know, so that's one of the ideas for this. The other one was that we thought if there was a taverna at Skopelos, where the first film was filmed,
yeah,
there might have been an owner called Nikos. And he, once the movie was a success, people came, tourists came to the island just to see the sights where, you know, where Meryl Streep sang The Winner Takes It All,
yeah,
and all of that. So we imagined that there was this guy, Nikos, who came up with a fantastic idea of having a Mamma Mia party every evening in his taverna. And then we just took that taverna to the O2. And there's Nikos, there's his family and friends. And there's the taverna with olive trees and fountain and everything. And a story in real time takes place every evening in that taverna.
Okay, so it's ABBA songs.
Yes.
So it's all the songs we know.
Yeah.
But they tell a story. I mean, but the restaurant works. I mean, you do get food. And
you get the most wonderful Greek Mediterranean food. And the action takes place, you know, among you. And but it's a story told through spoken dialogue, very witty, funny, mostly by Sandy Toksvig.
Oh yes,
and ABBA songs and the lyrics of ABBA songs. But it's nothing to do with Mamma Mia other than that it's kind of inspired by it.
Like if you hadn't seen Mamma Mia, would you sit in the restaurant going, "What on earth is going
no,
on?"
You wouldn't. You'd directly be in another story.
Okay.
So even if you hate Mamma Mia, you can go.
It's unlikely, but we're doing what? So tell me, this has been running in Sweden. You've had one. Is it in Stockholm? Presumably?
It's in Stockholm for 3.5, almost 4 years now.
Wow. And is it, I mean, is it Swedish people who go to it or is it tourists?
No Swedish people, because the dialogue is in Swedish in Sweden.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so mostly Swedish people.
And obviously, you know, you're from Sweden, but, you know, often, you know, home places often feel, particularly when you have such huge global success, there's a bit of, who do they think they are? You know?
Yes, there is.
I know where they were reared.
Yes.
But clearly it's not like that for ABBA in Sweden. Swedish people adore you.
It's a bit like that. You know, they're used to us.
They're going to your restaurant for 4 years.
It's because people have fun. They had such fun, you know. And thing is, they can relax because they don't have to hurry through that pre-theater dinner and then to the show. And then after the show, maybe they want to go dancing. And here it's all wrapped into one because
It
ends with a big disco.
Yes, so tell me about this. So the tables, it sounds, so the tables disappear.
The tables disappear and there's a stage where there's a kind of spectacular Skopelos ABBA show. And then that goes into a disco. Okay. So people dance and people can stay there for about 3-4 hours if they want to.
And you're going to be there at the opening night?
I am, yes.
Now, are you nervous of ABBA fans plus alcohol equals... Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't like to be your security.
I'm not so nervous about the ABBA fans. I don't think they get drunk, but there are others.
And so Sandy has done it here. Sandy Toksvig's done it here. So is it a different story than the one they have in the Swedish?
No, the story's the same.
Oh, okay.
Which I wrote together with two other guys. And then Sandy has adapted it together with me to English.
And where in the O2 is it? What was there before?
Yeah, there was a nightclub, a big nightclub.
Oh, okay.
You know, the O2 has the arena in the middle.
Yeah.
And, like, around it is a street.
Yeah.
Like an entertainment street, really, like a mini Las Vegas.
It is.
Yeah. And along that street was one nightclub, which we've taken over.
And so how many people can go every night?
I think we have 515 seats.
Wow.
Or chairs, you know.
Yeah. So it's a big operation.
Yeah, it's quite intimate, you know. It's much smaller than your theater. You would like the Prince Edward is like 1600, I think.
And tell me this, so obviously it's done very well in Sweden. If it is a huge success here, which it sounds like it's already booked out, I think, for months.
Yeah.
Is the plan that Mamma Mia the Party will spread?
Yes.
Spread like a jolly virus.
I hope so. Like the jolly virus that Mamma Mia the Musical was.
Yeah.
Which I think, you know, it was 20 productions or something at the same time at one point.
So do you have plans to...
We do have plans. The first stop, I think, will be Las Vegas.
Yeah.
And then after that, it's probably New York or Hamburg.
Okay.
And then there's, you know, Melbourne, Tokyo, Shanghai, Seoul.
Yeah. Wherever people have ears and mouths.
Yes.
You can go there.
Yeah.
And the cast in this, it's because you kind of think, oh, look, it's people, you know, singing in a restaurant. But it's a top-notch cast.
It's a top-notch cast. And they sing, they act, and they have a lot of fun because they kind of get the response from the audience straight away. Like, they're eye to eye with them.
No, because some of them have been in Mamma Mia in the West End, haven't they?
Yes. Yeah. Joe Munro has been Rosie, for instance.
Yeah.
Yes.
But they don't have to kind of sling plates, do they?
They don't do that. But we have waiters and waitresses who have been auditioned for this.
Oh, okay.
So they dance and sing as well.
Terrible waiters, but they're very good at the singing and dancing.
Yes.
I'm sure they're very good at that as well. Right, let's take a break. But we'll hear more about all the other stuff you're going on in your life.
Yeah.
But right now, here's one of the songs you'll hear at Mamma Mia the Party. It's Does Your Mother Know? It's like Mamma Mia the Party right here, right now, with coffee and some Jersey biscuits.
Oh, you've got Sullivan coffee, have you?
Have you not got a coffee?
No.
Oh,
they better get me one.
Yeah.
White coffee.
Yeah. A white coffee, please. Yeah. Yes. Yes, I'm sending Mr. Alves into a coma. Right. Quickly, let's go on with some other questions. So you've got Mamma Mia the Party at the O2, and then while you were there, while you're in the O2, you've also got an exhibition opening. Now, is that a permanent thing, or is it just going to be there briefly?
I don't think it's a permanent thing, but I'm not that involved in that because I try to... You know, museums and to be involved yourself.
I mean, it is weird that it's a museum of you.
Yes, yeah. It's weird.
Have you seen my museum?
Yes, my artifacts.
Yes, here's some beard trimmings from 1978.
Yeah.
Because the ABBA Museum in Stockholm, it's been there for quite a few years now, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been there for 6-7 years, I think, yeah.
So are they sending some things from there to here? Is that how this is working?
I think so. But they might be telling the story in a different way as well.
Okay.
There was an exhibition at the South Bank.
Oh, I remember
some
that.
Time ago.
Yes.
Yes.
In fact, I think you were here to talk about it.
I think it's roughly like that, or a bit different.
Okay. Yeah. But people could handily go and see it before they go to Mamma Mia and the Party.
Yes. Yeah. Good suggestion.
It'd be a nice day out.
Yes. Yeah. A nice day out.
I've done very well, I think, to not mention this till now. But we know that there is new music coming.
Yeah.
So this has been, you recorded it, like, we heard about these songs so long ago.
I know. And
they're old songs now.
Yeah, old unheard songs. I went out too early and promised, you know, that you'll hear them next year. And it's been delayed because technical problems, and we're building these digital copies of ourselves, and it took much longer than we thought.
Now, this
but next year.
So hang on, this is the Avatar tour.
Yeah, it's not going to be a tour, I think. It's going to be stationary. But
go to it.
Yes, exactly. But I can't say where and quite when yet. I'm sorry. It's
Have you seen
too much already?
Have you seen your Avatar?
I have seen my avatar at 85%.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's 15%
from the head down, or the feet up.
From the pores and inwards.
And so what? I mean, how old is your avatar?
He's from 1979.
Okay.
So he would be 34.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when they sing, is it 1974 ABBA voice, or is it you now? Because obviously, if these avatars are singing the new songs,
this will be us now.
Okay.
If they sing old songs, it'll be us then.
So you're not going to re-record anything?
No.
Okay.
Yeah. But there will be live music as well. But, you know, the other three have said, don't say too much about it. So I'm keeping, you know.
See, here's my theory.
Yeah.
My theory is that the four of you will see those avatars and kind of think, oh, wouldn't it be lovely? And you will go again.
I don't think so.
That's my theory.
Yeah,
We'll see. I think you'll see them. You'll see the reaction of the crowd. And you think, why are the avatars getting all the love? We could be having this.
Yeah.
That's what's going to
happen. Yeah. Who knows?
Those avatars are going to be in it for about a month, and then you're going to take over.
Yeah. Okay.
And the two new songs, what can you tell us about them?
One is kind of timeless in a sense that it's no particular style. It's more it's
a ballad.
Melody, a ballad type of thing with a reflective, slightly philosophical lyric.
Okay.
And it's called I Still Have Faith in You. And the other one is a more up-tempo, almost disco 70s kind of number called Don't Shut Me Down.
And what was it like writing for ABBA again?
It was great fun. It was, we started by, Benny and I thought, you know, now that we have these avatars, why don't we write a couple of new songs for them? And we called the ladies and asked them if they were up to it to record again. The last time we did that was in winter 1982.
Wow.
But they said,
it was a long winter.
Yes, of course. So we wrote these songs, and it was such great fun to be together in the studio again.
And so all four of you were together in the studio? You didn't do it separately?
No, we all four of us, like before. And it was, you know, it took 15 seconds, half a minute, to come back into 1982 again.
But it must have been really emotional, wasn't it?
Very emotional. Very. You know, you suddenly realize, my God, the bonds that we have, the things we have done and what we have together is incredible, especially in view of the fact that we thought that you know, a couple of years after we split up, we'd be forgotten. And then all these other things happened, and here we are. And we have a reason to be here. That was amazing.
And that's what kind of confuses us, I suppose, is that, you know, because I've talked to the other members of ABBA in the studio, and they've talked about what you're talking about, that emotional thing that you all share.
Yeah.
Why would you not reform in some way? I know you have kind of reformed in a way, but would you not want to all appear on stage together just because it would be like the best gift to the world?
I don't know. I think it's not, none of us really wants to do that. It's such a hassle. It's such a huge thing to do. People think, well, you just reunite to, you know, for one night. But it's not like that. It takes too much energy right now when, you know, we're geriatrics. But anyway, elderly pop stars.
We'd watch you sitting down. You wouldn't need to do the stepping from side to side.
No. Okay, no dancing, just sitting down. But I can tell you, they sing very well still.
And so you've written the two new songs, but did you then kind of keep going? Is there going to be an album?
I don't think so, but you never know. We could there could be a few others. We'll see.
Okay.
Yes.
Because
we had fun. It was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I suppose actually the way the music is released now, you don't need to do an album. You just release songs and people.
On the other hand, the album was such a nice format, I thought, you know, to a piece of work in a quite a different way than just the odd song is.
Yeah. And the TV special that you've announced that you're doing with NBC and BBC, is that the Avatars?
That I don't know if that's going to happen. That's to be seen. But no, we haven't decided how we're going to launch the Avatars yet.
Okay.
No. I'm sorry I sounded so secretive, but you know I've been.
Where are the Avatars now? Are they in a shed somewhere?
I mean, no, they're on a server somewhere.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a library of face muscles. In combination with animation.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm intrigued.
It's no one has done it before, so it's all new.
Yeah. And listen, very quickly, this is great. You've come up with a thing for fellow songwriters because of the way that music is written nowadays.
Yeah.
And because of the rights and stuff like that. So you've got an app. This is the Sessions.
Yeah.
Session app. And how does it work?
Well, nowadays there are, you know, sometimes 15 songwriters on the same song, and there are easily conflicts because one songwriter thought that he would have 20% and he was only given 10, and then there's a conflict and the money is not paid out at all. This is about early registration for songwriters and for publishers and for record companies. And it's something, I have a vision of this becoming something really important in the future.
Well, because I think it's going to be, isn't it? Because it's so much harder to keep track of.
It is. It is very hard. And the music industry is so complex with, you know, so many different codes for a song, for a songwriter, for a publisher, for a label. They all have different codes. And the idea about Session is to have all these codes in one place.
And so Session will be recognised internationally?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We
are working on it.
Yeah, so you came up with the idea, and then what, somebody else is doing all the technical
bit? No, someone came to me years ago with the idea, and I've, together with him and these people I'm working with now, have developed it.
Oh, wow. Well done you. And now, we are going to talk with Bjorn some more. But right now, we've got your song choice. Of all the songs in all the world, what has Bjorn Ulvaeus chosen?
I did choose one, didn't I?
It's on a piece of paper.
It's in a piece of paper. These days.
No, that's the wrong piece of paper.
This is funny. Someone told me.
You were looking down thinking, did I really choose? My name is Louis Theroux. There's your piece of paper. Katy Perry, Roar. And that was the choice of my guest, Bjorn Ulvaeus. Mamma Mia, the party is now at the O2 in London and it's booking until February 2020. Christmas, going to the bun fight, it'll be a Christmas. Good luck, everybody. right, now, Bjorn, we've had so many questions. So to get into it, we're just going to do a very simple true or false idea. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is ABBA, true or false. Here we go. Mm-hmm. This is our quick fire round.
Mm-hmm.
An American businessman offered you all $1 billion to record a new album and go on tour.
True.
Wow. Was it a billion each?
No.
Okay. That wasn't a question. That was me just asking that. Before you the name ABBA, you were known as Festfolk?
No.
So that's false.
That's false.
Okay, false. I probably pronounced Festfolk wrong. It's funny. Yeah. Your stage outfits were tax deductible.
False.
Okay. Neil Sedaka wrote the English lyrics on Ring Ring.
True.
The song Waterloo wasn't inspired by the famous battle, but the London Rail Terminus.
False.
ABBA was Sweden's second biggest selling export, behind vehicle manufacturer Volvo.
False.
No, I think that's true. Is that true? That's true, isn't it? It's true. Yeah, sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, Volvo, they outsold you. Tim Rice first asked you and Benny to work on The Lion King before Elton John.
False.
Is it?
Mm. Tim Rice didn't ask us.
Oh, okay. but you were asked. You and Benny performed Dancing Queen with U2. Is that true?
True.
Wow. I hope this is true. There was an ABBA fragrance called Arrival.
Might be true.
What are you wearing? Arrival. Arrival by ABBA.
I think it should have been true.
It should have been true. I'm going to make it.
Yeah.
The last time you guys performed live in concert was in Japan in 1980. Is that true?
False. 81.
81, but it was Japan.
Yeah.
Okay. And ABBA Gold will be reissued as ABBA Platinum next year, featuring the new songs.
False, as far as I know.
That's sort of true, isn't it? Yeah. There's something very close to true about that.
I didn't say that.
No, you didn't. I did. All right, here we go. These are listeners' questions, so let's get into these. Mark in Brighton says, do you remember the first time you picked up the guitar and were your parents musical? Was it kind of encouraged in your home?
No, it was... I got my first guitar when I was 11. For a Christmas present, but the first time I
took did you
that,
want it? Did you? Did you say? Oh,
I'd been, you know, asking and begging, and you know, my parents were sick of my nagging, and I held it in my arms the first time, I think in September that year. And then I knew this had to be mine. And I got it.
Oh, wow.
And I was part... It was because my cousin had started something called a skiffle group. There are some of the older listeners who will know what that is.
Yes, I know what skiffle is. Yeah.
Oh, you know. Yeah. Okay. So the Vipers, we were our idols. And we started a skiffle group, and that's how I started playing guitar.
Okay. And but when you held it in the September, did you know that you had a kind of a bit of an ear for it, that you could make it sound good?
I think so. At that point I felt as though we belonged together. So, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you still have that guitar?
It's in the museum. You have a museum too?
Of course I do. It's called my attic.
Everyone has one.
Yeah. No, that is the funny thing. We all have a museum of ourselves.
Yes.
It's just that people can go to yours. Around the world, what has been your favourite studio to record in and why? Anthony in Liverpool.
Well, absolutely the Polar Studio in Stockholm, which we built ourselves.
Okay.
I mean, we we absolutely custom-built it to stay there for months, you know.
Yeah.
So that was the best one.
And do other people use it now?
It's not there anymore, I don't think.
Is it in a museum?
Parts of it, yes. True.
Nothing's thrown away.
But there were people recording, like Led Zeppelin recorded an album in there, and other people.
Yeah. This is Freya in Newport. How and why did ABBA's Spanish album come about? And were you confident the lyrics were true to the originals?
I had learned a bit of Spanish at school, and we all thought that Spanish is a great language to sing in. So basically, that's why we did it.
Yeah.
Because we never did an album in any other language but Spanish. I once sang in my skiffle group a song called Spanish is the Loving Tongue, and I suppose that's what it is.
you remember
and
that. Yeah.
And it sounds really good. Chiquitita sounds good. Fernando sounds good in Spanish.
Yes, there is a Spanish connection. Yeah. Nathan in Bristol wants to ask about Stig Anderson and how important he was to the early success of ABBA.
He was our music publisher, and he was a mentor for Benny and me. In the beginning, as we started producing records for his label, which we became co-owners later of. And yes, especially in the beginning, he was very important. He was a lyricist as well, so sometimes he would come up with great ideas, especially for titles. So it's his Mamma Mia, for instance, is his title.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So quite a lot of the songs he's worked with Benny and me on.
And actually, Toby in Durham wants to know, was it his idea to flip the B in ABBA? Who came up with that idea of flipping the B?
I think that was one of the sleeve designers we had, the record sleeve designers, who came up with the idea to make that a logo.
Yeah, it was clever, really clever.
Yeah, it's good, it's good.
Amber in Braintree writes, thanks, Amber. I've read that ABBA is a brand of fish in Sweden. Is that true?
That is true.
What sort of, is it like sardines or something?
They have sardines. They have marinated herring.
Lovely.
And stuff like that that we eat at midsummer. And it's also true that we had to ask them if we could use the name ABBA.
But I'm surprised you wanted to use the name ABBA after it's tinned fish.
we did not want to use the word ABBA. It's a terrible name, to be truthful. But you know, people started calling us by our initials because it was too long to say Agneta, Benny, Bjorn, and Anifrid all the time.
Yeah.
So they started calling us ABBA. And in the end, we didn't have a choice.
Oh, okay.
So that's how that came about.
Emma and Shrewsbury, I love Chess. I still have the double album on vinyl. Do you and Benny have plans to write another English language musical?
Not at the moment, no.
I mean, that is, you know, when you're talking about the hassle of performing together again, I mean, putting a musical together, that is work, isn't it?
That is hard work. That takes a long time and it's very hard work.
And there's no guarantee at the end that it's going to be a success.
No, never. No. So that's you taking a big risk with maybe 4 years of your life.
Yeah.
So it takes a really good idea to start doing it. And I thought, you know, when the idea came up with writing a musical around existing songs in Mamma Mia, when Judy Kramer came with that idea, I thought, Jesus, that's exciting. Let's see if that works.
And easy. That's exciting and easy because I've written it all already. I have read you like gadgets. What was your favourite piece of musical gadgetry from the 1970s? Olivia in Sheffield. Are you quite kind of nerdy in the studio? Do you know how it all works?
Not really, but we always had the latest stuff because Michael B. Tretto, who was a sound engineer, he was very into that, and Benny was always from the first he was really interested in synths and stuff. We had the first ever synth, I think, called Mini Moog. And you can hear it in the beginning of the chorus of SOS. That's a Mini Moog. That's one of the first synths.
That is some good music trivia.
Yes.
Yeah. Ashley in London. Who was Fernando?
Fernando was the husband of the girl, the lady who sings Fernando. And they were both freedom fighters in Pancho Villa's army when he tried to make Mexico free sometime in the late 1800s.
Wow.
Yes. And they're sitting on their veranda, their patio, and it's night, it's a starry night, and they're reminiscing about what happened back then in one of the battles.
Well, who knew? I just thought it rhymed with things. I thought that's why it was Fernando.
No, it doesn't even rhyme.
Julian Warrington, out of the 8 ABBA studio albums, which one is your favourite?
Oh, we tried to develop, you know, take one step for every album, both with everything that's happened in technology around us, and also what was happening musically, impulses we got. So there's not really one favourite, because they're all different and they're from different periods.
Do you listen to them ever?
I listen to them, you know, when they're played on the radio in my car or something like that. It's not like I put on a CD with ABBA at home. No, I don't do that.
Well, when it came to writing the new ABBA songs, which are the first actual ABBA songs you'd written, did you revisit any of ABBA's music then to kind of get yourself in the mood or to remind yourself of the voices, or was it just in you?
I didn't have to be reminded, because I have been reminded all this time.
In fairness, yes. Sarah in Bournemouth, why did you decide to build your own hotel in Stockholm? Well, I presume it's all the people going to your restaurant and your museum. They need somewhere to stay.
Exactly. It goes with the restaurant and the museum.
Leaving ABBA things, you know, Mamma Mia and things like that aside, what of your kind of your business ventures have been kind of the most successful? Is it
the most interesting and most successful is together with a partner, I have bought a theatre in Stockholm called Circus, and another big hotel which is just adjacent to the theatre, and so we plan to build kind of an international entertainment destination in that part of Stockholm.
Wow.
And that's ahead of me. It's great fun.
It's all ahead of you. It is. We were saying during the record, it is fabulous that, you know, all these years later, that there's this, you know, fervour for anything ABBA. Thank you so much for coming in, Bjorn.
Thank you.
Mamma Mia the Party, now the O2 London, booking until February 2020. And to say goodbye to you, Bjorn, here's another ABBA classic, also featured in Mamma Mia the Party. The winner takes it all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
That's the last one today. ABBA, the winner takes it all. Huge thanks to all of my guests today, Gilbert O'Sullivan, Louis Theroux, and of course, Bjorn Ulvaeus. What a nice man, and so generous to give us all that time. And we hope we got around to your question. Also thanks to Maria and Orna, and behind the glass, Malcolm, James, Gary, and Sarah.